Allow me to tell you the story of last weekend. For those of you who weren't here and maybe are still trying to piece things together, I would like to tell you about what happened in the life of our church. Unexpectedly and I think changing the trajectory of not just a service but a ministry, and allow that to set up where I'd like to go in the scriptures. Last weekend, I was getting ready to come out here on stage after the third song, and I was coming from the back room, using the restroom. Maybe that's too much information, but coming out to go to the stage and about to turn right to go to the stage, only to have my wife running at me, saying, "Skip's down in the lobby." I didn't have to think, who is Skip? There's not many guys named Skip, and it's the only one I know of, and the only one I knew of at Grace Chapel. So instead of turning right to go to the stage, I ran straight to the lobby, only to find this man that I adore, this man that was a sweet friend, laying there. His shirt was just being ripped open by our medical team, who was beginning life-saving resuscitation to bring him back to life or to ensure that he had life. I couldn't get my mind around what was happening, and you all watched me live that out in front of you. I ran back in, I grabbed the stage, and you all were doing a turn and greet, you're greeting one another, turning in your seats, and I said, "We have to pray, we got to stop, we just got to pray," and that's all I knew what to do. I just knew that the saints of God had to do the work of God, which was to pray and seek God in hopes that something would stop, something would change. In case you don't know who Skip is, I would like to show you this picture of his wife and him fishing not too long ago. Skip served faithfully. You probably passed him many times if you didn't know him, because again, as I mentioned earlier, he served in our security team. He was keeping us safe every single Sunday that he served with his son Tanner. And he was standing right at those doors, and suddenly his life was taken from him. We prayed, we stopped, we prayed. You guys were amazing. Thank you. Thank you for what you did to just go with it. We had turned and prayed together on January 1st, the week prior, and so that somehow sovereignly set us up for a moment that seemed not all too together unfamiliar to, okay, I don't know who these people are that I'm praying with, but I'm going to pray. I don't know who I'm praying for, but I'm going to pray. And you all just started to seek the Lord. And Josh Kirk, our pastor on staff of care and counseling, came up and helped lead through that. Back and forth, I went between here and there, trying to just make sense of what was happening. I remember at one point grabbing his foot and kneeling down and just praying, "Lord, come on, we need Skip to live. So please save his life, preserve his life." The next 45 minutes were absolutely unfathomable for me, because they continued to work hard to resuscitate him. As we look back now, he was probably gone the very second that he went down on the ground. But they continued to do everything they could to try to save his life. And his wife, Leanne, was taken to the cry room, which is right here for mothers of crying babies, the cry room. Ironically and appropriately titled the cry room. That day it was definitely the cry room, as everybody came around her, friends who knew her, my own mother, my wife, people that were trying to just love on her and help her as the worst, the unfathomable was happening just right outside the door. Leanne and Skip have known each other since they were one. They had, I think, over 37 years of marriage together, if I understand correctly. They started falling in love and dating when they were in high school. Funny stories about pranks that Skip would pull on Leanne and trying to somehow win her heart in a high school love kind of way. How do you get your mind around someone being taken from you like that in a church, nonetheless? You can't. There's no way to think through that. I was able to get to know Skip by taking he and Leanne to Israel. I grew up in the church, and so I knew of the Gossics, but I got to really know them over the last 7 years, and then most intimately in 2019 when we went to Israel together. And he's funny. We had a great time hiking all over Israel, and he has just a sense of humor about him that was so endearing. You just wanted to spend time with him. He was amazing at storytelling, though his stories often went on and you would wonder, is there a caboose on this train? Like, is where? And he would laugh about that too, right? Everybody knew that about him. I knew if I ran into him on Sunday mornings, which when he was serving in security, we would talk back here by my prayer room, and we would always have a sweet conversation. And he told me just a couple weeks ago that Chandler and I and he and Tanner were going to maybe go fishing in the spring. And obviously that plan has changed. I pray there is a day I get to go fishing with him and spend time with him. His smile was huge. His warmth was amazing. He had a heart as big as he was. Last Sunday, he falls over in our lobby, serving you all, protecting you all. I often say Grace Chapel is the safest place you could possibly be on a Sunday because of our security team. I still believe that, but to a whole new level, it's the safest place you can be anywhere in South Denver, or Denver for that matter, because of our medical team. The medical team stepped right in. They were there and quick. As soon as he went down, even those who were not on shift, if you will, jumped in. My sister being one of those, his daughter-in-law on our medical team also stepped in doing compressions on her own father-in-law's chest in our lobby. Come on. There's no way to even get your mind around that. They stepped in and they did whatever they could to possibly save his life or to bring him back to life. Nick Berard had just had a long conversation with him. He told me on the phone, maybe 20 minutes. I said, how blessed are you, man? You got the last 20 minutes of his life on earth to talk with him. Had this amazing conversation. He goes down, he falls at my daughter Gracie's feet, and she's had to deal with her own thoughts about that moment. She thought Skip was kind of joking with her, that he would just lay down in the lobby. And I thought how sweet it is that Skip got to see, I call her my little angel, the face of an angel before he saw the angels. That's been a comforting thing for us, right, Grace? To know that God used you, maybe even the last moment as he saw your face, Skip saw your face before he left. It was an unbelievable morning. And just to finish the storyline, you all cleared out of here, and we were here till 2 o'clock when finally the coroner finished everything that needed to be done, and the family came around and stood by Skip's body in the lobby. It was myself and the family and Skip's body. It's his shell, right? He's not there anymore. He's in glory. But we stood there, and it was a sweet moment. It was a prayerful moment. Leanne in her sweet sense of humor. She said, "You stinker. You weren't supposed to do this. You weren't supposed to leave me yet." And we prayed and processed it, and they took his body away, and then the people, there was a group of people that were in the room with Leanne, and they all stayed till the very last moment, even after his body had been removed, and there was just community. You just can't even imagine. I mean, the gospel is what sustains us in a moment like this. When life and death doesn't make sense, we trust the gospel. But we are not just called to Christ, we're called to his people. And I watched his people come around Leanne, and it's been happening all week for her. She said on the phone to Molly and I last night, she's been sustained by the prayers that she's experienced from you all and the way that you prayed for her that day, and you've prayed for her this week. And Tanner and Megan and Amanda and Michael and Levi, they've all been supported by your prayers, but the community is what upheld them. Skip and Leanne had a sweet marriage, but it was centered upon Christ, and they understood Christ's faithfulness in their marriage. The smiles in Israel, they would hold each other and smile at the sights. I was just sent this picture from Joy Fowler in our body of them holding each other in one of our last days there in Jerusalem, just enjoying each other's presence. And their whole life was based upon Christ. They just wanted to love him and serve him. And they had this resolve in their life to serve him and be so selfless. And Leanne, last night on the phone, she's telling Molly and I, she's saying, even though Skip's not here, I'm going to keep doing what we said we were going to do. I'm going to keep living selflessly. I'm going to keep living for Christ. From what I know of this man, he had a compelling profession of faith. He believed in Jesus Christ, and the fruit of his life was that he had a relationship with Christ. So I believe that in his death, God is going to use him, perhaps even greater than he could have used him in his life. And that doesn't make sense to us. I said that to Leanne last night. Why would God seemingly use someone after they were gone? That seems a bit unfair. God never promised to be fair. God just promised to make his glory known, and he's doing that through Skip Gossick's life being taken from us. Yes, last Sunday and the many moments since then have been unbelievable for me pastorally and as a friend. I had this moment, I think it was Tuesday or Wednesday, I'm up in the wee hours of the morning and just the waterworks, right? I just started weeping, just the images of what we saw, and I know many people here saw things they can't get out of their mind. You're trying to get past those, but then the loss of Skip, and then what does this mean for us, and then what does it mean for my own life? All of that is to be thought through biblically. That's what I want to do now. What do we do with this? My friend's life is shorter than any of us imagined. It's going faster than we first realized. And it's more fleeting than we'd ever like to admit. The Bible tells us that life is a vapor, a mist. And we ask these questions, is my life of any value? When I'm gone, will anyone care that I'm gone? The older you get, the more you ask these questions, the more you wonder about your legacy, the more you wonder, have I done everything the way that I should have done it? The things I didn't do, I can't go back and fix. What do I do now? Today, I want to talk about the joy of walking with God. I believe that Skip Gossick walked with God. His profession of faith and the fruit of his life compels me to believe that he walked with God. Walk with God? Hold on. Can a person really know their Creator in such a close and personal way that they can walk with him? I want to show you a man who walked with God. Open your Bibles with me to Genesis chapter 5. Genesis chapter 5 is a genealogy report of all the first humans who lived on earth. It's a bit of a odd chapter, and if you've been working on your Bible reading for the year, I'm going to imagine you've come across this already and probably speed read your way through it. The creation account is riveting. Genesis chapter 1 and 2 tell us how the world was created. The Genesis 1 account tells us creation, recounted chapter 2, chapter 3. We have the sin that enters the world and the fall of mankind. And then you have the first death in chapter 4. Didn't take us long to get to death. Four chapters in Genesis. By the fourth chapter, we have the first death. It's death by murder, nonetheless. So not only did we get to the first death, we got to the first death by murder. Cain and Abel, that story is recounted for us in Genesis chapter 4. And then in Genesis chapter 5, after we get through that horrible moment, we get to the genealogy of what all the first humans who lived. And again, seemingly odd, it's telling us how long they lived before they had their first child, and then how long they lived afterwards. But I think there's a principle in this chapter, something that the author is doing. He's telling us something. I think what he's trying to tell us is that the length of our life is not what is most important, but it is closeness with God that determines the quality of our life and our legacy. Is closeness with God dependent on the number of years that we live? That's a question you should ask as you read Genesis chapter 5. Evil is spreading. Cain and Abel murder happens in chapter 4. And now, because evil is continuing almost as a part of God's judgment, death is now upon the earth. This wasn't part of God's original design. Back in Genesis chapter 1, he created man and woman to live in the garden in an unhindered relationship with him, seemingly forever, with no end to life. But because now sin entered in chapter 3, exhibited for us in chapter 4. Now death is entered into all mankind. In chapter 5, you can see it for yourself, there is this doom-filled statement repeated 8 different times. It's repeated again in Genesis chapter 9. So 9 times altogether, this statement says over and over, and he died. And he died. Seemingly emphatic that death was the end for all people. And I would say seemingly cold-hearted and harsh. You're just going to tell us, live this many years, and he died. Live this many years, and he died. Come on. But this repeated phrase makes it clear that death is the inevitable end for all of us. And this early in Genesis, only 5 chapters into the Torah, 5 chapters into the first 5 books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, 5 chapters into what we call the Bible, this is telling us death is coming. It is the ultimate lot for everyone because sin is a part of the world. Look at it with me. Follow these verses. I'll just call out the different people. The first human listed there in verse 5. He lived. It follows this pattern, tells us how long he lived. He had his first son, Seth, and then how many years he lived afterwards. Verse 5 concludes with adding those 2 numbers together, saying all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died. Verse 8, all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. All the days of Enosh were 905 years, and he died. Verse 14, all the days of Kenan were 910 years, and he died. Jump down to 17, all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years, and he died. Verse 20, all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. Verse 23, all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Verse 31, all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. And then chapter 9, verse 29, all the days of Noah were 950 years, and he died. The statement is quite a statement, and he died. Again, death wasn't a part of God's original plan, but now, chapter 5 of Genesis, it's seemingly the plan. Everyone seemingly is dying. The entrance of sin happens, and they all die. Now, the length is something to be noted. 900 years, 9 of them, besides the shortest, which is Enoch, lived an average of 900 years. I got to be honest with you. I do not want to live 900 years. There's no way that I would ever want to live that long. Having kids in the 300s? Come on. And Mahalalel, this guy, he didn't even quite make it to 900. Maybe he was praying, like, please don't let me live to 900 years. 895 years Mahalalel lives. 7 out of the 9 of them, including Noah, lived into their 900s. Lamech died at 777. Perhaps that was because he had his own stress or his own hope deferred. That's a story for another day. He just couldn't take it anymore. And he died seemingly young at 777 years. But if you're reading it with your eyes wide open, there's a deviation from the formula. The author is telling us something. The 7th person listed is a man named Enoch. And in verse 22, it says, all the days of Enoch were 365, and he was not. Mathematicians, just do some work on this with me, okay? If the average of all the others is 915 years, then we could conclude that Enoch, living only 365 years, only lived 39% as long as everyone else. He had the shortest life of everyone mentioned in Genesis chapter 5, but he also birthed the one who lived the longest. Look at verse 22. Zoom in with me. Verse 22 of chapter 5 of Genesis. Enoch walked with God after he fathered Methuselah 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Genesis 5:24. Enoch walked with God and he was not, for God took him. a deviation from the formula. He's the only one who does not say, and he died. It's the only one that says, walked with God. It's the only one mentioned that God took him. The author's doing something here. What's he trying to show us? I think what he's trying to get at is that those who live a life of walking with God can experience or attain a reward of intimacy with God that lasts forever. I think he's making an implied point that death is never an end for the righteous. Let me explain to you more how I got there. If you look at his life, he's walking with God, mentioned twice, walked with God. He has this closeness with God, though he lived 39% as long as everybody else. He had a closeness with God and a short life. Therefore, I would conclude then that closeness with God is not dependent upon the length of our life. Listen to that clearly. Closeness with God is not dependent upon the length of our life. In my opinion, Skip was taken from us far too early. His life was far too short. He was 56 years old. That's short. He's taken from us early. And in our eyes, we could contend with God, listen, you should have given him more years. If he would have walked with you, he would have had more days with you, glorified you more, done more for you. But God doesn't look at things the same way that we look at things. So we say, he's 56, he shouldn't have been taken. And God says, no, it doesn't matter. Length of life doesn't matter. He walked with me, and we can say by his profession of faith, the fruit of his life, he was walking with God. And so God suddenly takes him. And one thing that should be extremely clear to you in life, yet alone the Bible, is that death does not discriminate. It is the end for all of us. Death takes the young and the old. It is the inevitable end for all of us. I just finished reading a book recently called Therefore I Have Hope. I recommend it to you. The author is Cameron Cole. He gives these 12 principles for what it means to follow God and be sustained in the midst of tragedy. And he himself lost his 3-year-old son who died suddenly in his sleep, and he had to figure out, how do I live past the worst of losing my son? He recounts his story in there and gives these biblical principles. It's wonderful. It's terrible to read, but wonderfully done in the way that it applies it to our life. You can't get past those moments of losing a young child like that, or losing someone 56. This week, I heard about a pastor friend of mine who had to bury a 9-week-old baby that was asleep on his father's chest, and the father rolled over and the baby suffocated. You don't know how do we even think of these things? It doesn't make sense. Death does not discriminate. It is the inevitable end for all of us. But we have hope. Our hope is that we can walk closely with God until we finally arrive at home. So closeness with God is not dependent upon the number of years that we live, the length of our life. I believe even a child, and in fact, Cameron Cole in his book, Therefore I Hope, Have Hope, he explains his child seemingly converts to following Jesus Christ, explains his faith in Jesus Christ. It's a profession of faith that is compelling. I would say, I don't think he's off base in that. So you can be close to God whether you're 3 or 56. But then that then has to lead to us concluding that I can actually be close with my Creator. Closeness with God is attainable. Enoch is portraying it here. Now, it doesn't mean that the others didn't have a relationship with God. Certainly they did. We know their Bible accounts, at least of some of them. But Enoch is explained as walking with God. And there's this key word that is used here. He walked with God. Walk. In the Hebrew, it's a beautiful word. It connotates this idea of ongoing repetition of side-by-side relationship. Walking with God is used in verse 22 and 24 here in Genesis chapter 5. It shows that Enoch was a man of deep connection. He was connected to God, and nothing was going to stand in the way of that connection. We see elsewhere in Scripture the idea of walking before God. The patriarchs are explained as walking before God. The psalmists in 114 and 56, they will say, I want to walk before God, or my life is before God. But this passage is different. It's telling us that Enoch walked with God. It doesn't just say Enoch lived. It replaces the idea that he lived with he walked with God. That's how it explains his life. A fair assessment of this Old Testament character, and I think even a fair assessment of what happened in Skip's life. He walked with God. It was the best way to explain. He didn't just live. He walked with God. What does it mean to walk with God? I would explain walking with God as this special intimacy that brings about piety and humility. I walk with God in such a way that I'm humble enough to realize he's the one in charge of everything. I'm in step with him, and I never want to be out of step with him. It's this picture of unity and friendship with him that cannot be stopped, that is unhindered. In the Greek translation of the Old Testament, known as the Septuagint, this word walk is actually translated as live. Even those who used Greek 2,000 years ago would have read this and thought, oh, it means lived. He lived with God. He didn't just live life. He lived with God. He continued to walk with him. It's different than walking or living our life before him. It's walking with him. Enoch walked with God. They were walking together. Jim Hamilton, a professor of mine, wrote it this way. He said, when two people do so, one can expect the superior one who's walking with him to take the initiative while the other accompanies him. For Enoch, consequently, wherever God decided to go, Enoch goes. This passage implies there was a closeness and a proximity and a companionship. Enoch is close and united with God in such a way that he is God's very intimate friend, and they were always together. What is the author doing here? The author is showing us, listen, this man was set apart. Not only in the way that he suddenly was not found, that's how it would read in the original language, he was not found. Nobody found him. Now, I imagine that this is a sort of death for him. We don't have his death described. I don't know exactly how he went. Some believe that he was just sucked right up into heaven. If I get up there and I see Enoch and say, hey, how'd you get here? I just got sucked up. Okay, I'll totally believe that. I'm all in on that. But if I see him and he goes, oh, I just had this sudden death. It was over for me. My body was nowhere to be found. It was just over for me. I would believe that too. Because the language carries, it just ended. By God's sovereign choice, it was just done. It was over with. And he was with God. The Hebrew word walk, it's in this imperative verb form. It's this idea of it's always going on. It never stops. 365 days a year, he never stopped walking with God. I believe the author is doing something absolutely poetic and profound. He uses this verb form of the word walk to indicate he walked with him every day of the year, 365 days of the year. And isn't it amazing that this man lived 365 years, almost as a poetic way to say every year he lived every day with God. And then, if that's not profound to you, in the original text, there are 365 words in Genesis chapter 5. Poetic. And standing at the middle of Genesis chapter 5, 200 words in, not quite the middle, but 200 words in, 100 words left after Enoch. It's explaining this man who 365 days a year for 365 years never stopped walking with God. There's an exception to the pattern. This man didn't just live and die. He walked with God. It's as if the author is trying to say something to us. He's saying those who walk with God do not die, but they just go on living. And we know in Jesus Christ that when we have hope in him, we go on living. Our hope is that we have Christ. We pass from this life to the next in whatever form death, according to earthly means, comes. But it's just a pass through. We go on living. We experience true freedom on the other side. Enoch, he was and then he was not. He went from being bound by the earth, hindered in his relationship with God, though as close as he possibly could be, he was still hindered by sin, nature, death, all the things that are part of this world. He suddenly went from being hindered to absolutely unhindered, totally free. Last weekend, Skip went from this life, hindered, to being in the presence of God, totally unhindered. I had said to everyone who was outside working with Skip and helping in that situation, I said, if he's pronounced as passed, I want you to come get me. And I came back in here, if you remember that, if you were in the service, I was trying to direct us to think like the gospel through this. And they signaled for me to come, and it was because he had been pronounced as dead. Human terms, right? We know he's fully alive. But I said, when that is made, I want to go in with Leanne. I want to be with her when we tell her. And so we went into the side room. You were all in here praying and singing. We went in the side room. And I was with Tanner, Skip's best friend, besides Leanne, his son. And Tanner confirms for his mom that Skip had passed. And I'm right there, and I confirm that he had passed. And she looks me in the eyes with all of her tears. In a moment I'll never forget. And she says, "He's free. He's free. Skip's free." She just kept saying it. I could only hope to have that kind of faith. She's right. He was free. He was absolutely free. And that's the blessing that comes with those who are righteous and walk with God, is that we go from here to there and we are free. We are free. My friends, a long life is not always the best blessing. I'll be honest, I'm a bit jealous of Skip. And I've had others say the same thing to me this week. He's just gone like that, experiencing the glory of God. He's free. In this world, if you know Jesus Christ, the life you experience here on earth is the closest to hell you will ever experience. Think about that. You won't get any closer to hell than this life, if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. But listen to me, if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this is the closest to heaven that you're going to get. Knowing Jesus Christ and having a walk with him means that we are promised that there is freedom and eternal life, all of his glory on the other side. That's what we're looking forward to. I was driving down County Line not too long ago, just within the last couple weeks, but before last week. And I was driving down, looking at the beautiful mountain range, and just overcome at the hill not far from the mall here. I was just overcome by this sense of, God, you sent your son to earth. And as beautiful as these Rocky Mountains are, this was like hell to him. You can't live with the triune Godhead in all of eternity and all of that's beauty and then come to earth and go, oh, this is nice. I mean, he certainly appreciated it, right? Certainly, it was God's creation. But he had to think, I'm as close to hell as I'm ever going to be. But he did it for you and he did it for me. So that this would be as close to hell as we ever have to be. Come on. He did it for us. To save our souls. To reconcile us to his Father. And I was overwhelmed before I got to Quebec, just praising God. Thank you that you would love me enough, that you would send your son to this place, as cool as I think it is, to earth to save my soul. And thank you that it doesn't end here with the Rocky Mountains and all that, that I get to be with you for all of eternity. Oh, he's so faithful. If you don't know him, I'm telling you, you have no hope of something better than this life. The pleasures you find in this life, the joys of this life, the possessions you have, that's your heaven. That's as close as you're ever going to get without Christ. But you have Christ, that's only the bottom. That's the Costco size sample of God's goodness. Okay? Do you want to live the rest of your life on Costco samples? Or do you want to have the hope that you get to have a feast for all of eternity with heaven? Come on. He's so faithful. I have a couple more things I want to share, but before I do, can we just stop and sing "Great is Thy Faithfulness"? Can we do that? That was a song that they sang in the room last Sunday, probably right around this time. And I think it's appropriate for us to sing it now. So let's just recount God's faithfulness and how he upholds us, all right? Let's sing.
Great is thy faithfulness. is not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning.
Closeness with God is not determined by the length of our life. Closeness with God is attainable in this life. But I also would submit to you that our closeness with God determines the quality of our life. The reason that a man like Skip can have the joy that he did and the hope that he had was because he was walking with the Lord. And I believe, though a sinner like all of us, though his own mistakes certainly, he was living the best that he could to please God. And the quality of our life, I do think, is dependent upon, are we pleasing God? And I see that a bit in Genesis chapter 5, verse 22 specifically, when it says that he was with God, it can also be translated as he pleased God. In fact, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, the Septuagint, does translate it that way and says he pleased God. And then in verse 24, and basically saying because he pleased God, he walked with God and he was no longer. The aim of our existence is to please God. That's why we live as Christians. If you're living for any other purpose than to please God, you're living for the wrong purpose. Let me be clear. The reason that we live as Christ followers is to please God. That's what Christ lived for, and that's what we also, as little Christ, little Christians, should be living for. However, isn't it seemingly ironic that you and I live to please so many other people? When we were children, we lived to please our parents. Even my one-year-old likes to go around the family room making us laugh. We go through school trying to please our teachers and our caretakers. We get into high school and we get a little bit more focused on pleasing our friends or the people around us. We get our first job and we want to please our boss. We get married if that's what the Lord has for us, and we want to please our spouse. We have kids and we want to please our kids. We have grandkids and we want to please our grandkids. And I suppose another person that we try to please is ourselves. We're constantly trying to please people, including ourselves, when the Bible tells us clearly that we are to please God and only God. That's who we should be living for. In fact, the Bible seems to portray that if we live to please God, it doesn't matter if anyone else is pleased with us. Others won't be pleased with us. Others will be mad at us. Others will be disappointed by us. But if we're living for God, living to please him, then we will find a life worth living, a quality of life much better than trying to run around spinning the plates of pleasing people and all those in our life. I have grown to believe that if I just will live to please the Lord, everyone else will be at least to some degree pleased. And if they're not, then God takes care of that. God takes care of those who are disappointed, and certainly some are disappointed in me, some are disappointed with you. But it can't affect me. Paul said that in Galatians chapter 1, verse 10, when he was talking about who am I living to please, he said, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ." Do you sense the absolute of what he's saying? If I'm living to please people, including kids, grandkids, spouse, friends, you name it, I then will not be living the life of servanthood towards Christ. But if I'm living to please God and not man, then I will be truly a servant of Christ. Truth be told, you and I will never be able to fully please God. That's why we need Christ. Christ pleased God. He's the ultimate servant and paid the price for us, and we have a relationship with him that only is ultimately fulfilled in Christ. God looks at us with favor and says, oh, in my child, you, my child, I am pleased. But because he looks at us through the lens of Christ. However, you and I are admonished many times in Scripture to remain in Christ, be in Christ, hidden in Christ, union with Christ. And as we live in him, we will please him. So our closeness with God will come from a heart to please him, which will then impact our quality of life. Your circumstances may be terrible. The job didn't come through. The paycheck didn't happen. The cancer results are what they are. These things rattle your cage, but in all of these things, you can rejoice and still have a high quality of life because you're close with the one who's in control of life. I would also assert then that our closeness with God determines our legacy. It determines our quality in life, but it also determines our legacy. Enoch had a legacy that lived on so that one of his great-grandchildren was Noah. And Enoch and Noah ended up being these posts in Genesis chapter 5 and 6 that stood high above all the rest who because they lived to please God. They lived to please him, and because they lived to please him, God saved the lineage and saved even all of humanity. Let me explain. In Genesis chapter 5, verse 22 and 24, the passages we've been looking at, it says that Enoch walked with God. In Genesis chapter 6, verse 9, it says Noah walked with God. The generations between Enoch in 5:22 and Noah in 6:9 were not always pleasing to God. In fact, there's this terrible story between verse 1 and 8 of Genesis chapter 6 that tells us God was so displeased with man that he regretted ever making them, that he was grieved in his heart for creating them. And yet these posts stand on either side of this disappointment hammock, Enoch and Noah, two men that walked with God. Their closeness with God determined their legacy. Skip has a sweet legacy to children that know Christ and that are following Christ. Nobody can guarantee the salvation of their children. I'm just saying that's part of Skip's blessing. His legacy will continue to live on, and hopefully Levi and any other grandkid that is born to them will continue to live in light of the gospel and live on to know Christ. But I will say this. Skip and Leanne resolve themselves to walk with God. And if we resolve ourselves to walk with God, God uses our testimony in our life, our legacy, to impact not only those around us, but the generations behind us. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 6 says, "So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord." This is the idea of obeying God. Well, how do I do that? By walking in his ways and by fearing him. You will live, and you will impact, and you will leave a legacy if you walk in his ways and fear him, meaning that you have a right view of him. So the world in front of the text, if we look at our life through the Bible, the world in front of the text that God is proposing for us, the glasses of the Bible are on us, and we look through it and say, okay, God, what is it that you want me to do with this passage? The world in front of this text is showing us that we can have an unhindered relationship with God, and we will have an unhindered relationship with God if we live to please him, and therefore we will have a quality of life and a legacy that will be unmatched because a sovereign God walked with us as our companion. Enoch was returned to Eden. God took man out of Eden because of his sin. The generations went on, evil generations lived, and now God takes Enoch and puts him back into an unhindered relationship with him, seemingly where death was no thing. The same word took is used in Genesis chapter 4, verse 19, when Lamech takes a wife, he took his wife, so God also took Enoch. This suggests that there's this new relationship founded, nothing standing between them. They've always been together, but now they remain together. They are even more so together. God took man, Genesis 2:15, and placed him in the garden. And God took Enoch and placed him in his presence. And so, my friends, in Jesus Christ, once and for all, we have been taken out of the grips of sin and death and placed into an eternal Eden, a relationship with our Father. What God once did for Enoch, God promises to do for us as we walk in an unhindered relationship with him. My friend, there is hope for us that someday we will be taken to a respite of this baned sin world that we live in, that we will be able to find true eternal rest and no longer be plagued by the pains of sin and death. So what do we do with this? Well, simply put, we walk with God. This passage, Skip's testimony, should encourage us to walk with God, but let me give you four ways to apply that in your life. Number one, you need to repent of your sin. If you have sin in your life that is keeping you from walking closely with the Lord, it could be private sin of you looking at things you shouldn't be looking at, thinking about things, lusting over things, contemplating things. You think nobody's hurt by this, stop it. It's hurting you. And it's causing a hindered relationship between you and God. Repent of your sin. Dispel the darkness that you're walking in. 1 John chapter 1, verse 6 says, if we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. If you're being unfair with people, you're cheating them in your business, you're sinning in some way against other people, I'm telling you, you repent of that sin. You turn and you stop walking in darkness and you walk in the light of Christ. You repent. The second thing is you obey God. You walk in a manner worthy of the gospel. You obey what he says. So often, I think we downplay the call to obedience in Christ. Yes, we are called to faith alone in Christ. Faith alone saves us. That's how we are saved by Christ. But because we are saved by Christ, we then walk in obedience to him. We must obey what he says. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 says, I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. We must walk, obey in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yes, it saved our soul, but it should change your whole life. And how you live your life and how you strive to obey God should constantly be coming out in all of the decisions you make, relationally, morally. All of these decisions should come back to the root call to obey Christ. And yes, of course, if you don't know Christ, then you should believe in Christ. You believe in him for your salvation, you repent, you obey, you believe, but you also every single day make a conscious choice to believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior to save you from your sins, but also the Lord over all the days of your life. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7 says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. We walk by faith. We have faith. We trust in the things we cannot see, and we rest upon a God who's holding all things together. Even if you find yourself walking in the valley of the shadow of death, you fear nothing because you're walking with a God who's sustaining all things. And finally, please the Lord. How do we walk with God? We repent, we obey, we believe, but we also please the Lord. We make it our very goal to please him in every single area of our life. If your eating patterns aren't pleasing God, then get them under control. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31 says, whether we eat and drink, whatever we do so for the glory of God. If your drinking patterns, your consumption of things, your verbal patterns, your relational patterns, if they're not pleasing to the Lord, come on, eradicate them, repent of them, and live in a life. Live a life that pleases the Lord so that you may walk with him. I know you are. Many of you are. I know that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1 says, finally then, brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us on how you ought to walk to please God, just as you are doing, that you do so more and more. It's a good verse. And I would use that for my brothers and sisters here at Grace Chapel. We must continue to walk in the way that pleases the Lord. And you are doing that, but do so more and more. And where you're not doing that, get on God's plan and start pleasing him. My friends, it is not the length of our life, but the closeness with God, our closeness with God, that will determine our life quality and our legacy. So strive to be close with God. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, there's no reason you should leave here today without saving faith in him. I want you to believe in him. Skip would want you to believe in him. If Skip was taking us from us for no other reason but to bring somebody to salvation today, that's worth it. That's amazing. And Leanne agreed with that on the phone last night. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've never actually put your faith in him, then all you simply have to do is express it to God and say, I believe that you sent your one and only son to die for me, to die for my sins. I believe that you rose him again from the dead, and I'm praying that that same power that was with him to raise him from the dead will help me get free from my sin and follow you, walk with you all the days of my life. Listen, I know there are others of you who are here today. You hear my voice, and you think, well, I've always been a Christian. I am a Christian, but that whole walking with God thing, it's not true of my life. Listen, some of you think you are a Christian and you're not a Christian. You're not following Christ. You're not walking with Christ. This is not something that we play. It is not a label that we take on. It is not a group of people we become a member with to say I have an identity with these group of people simply by association. You declare your faith in Jesus Christ. And yes, then you become a part of a people, a redeemed people, a holy nation, a royal priesthood, those people who are following Christ. But some of you think, I'm already in, and you're not. And I don't want your life to be taken from you suddenly, and you show up before Christ, and he says, I never knew you. Oh, I don't want that. So I want to give you a chance to respond to this right now. I'm going to ask you, close your eyes and bow your heads so that this is a personal experience between you and God. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you never have, or maybe you thought you had, but you're realizing maybe you don't, I want you simply to express your faith to God by saying to him in your own words, out of your own mind, out of your own heart, say, God, I believe you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to die for me. I believe that you raised him from the dead. And the same power that raised him from the dead, I'm asking now to save me from the consequences of my sin. Help me turn from my sin and walk with you all the days of my life. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Enoch's example. Thank you for Skip's example. And the thousands, dare I say, millions of people that have gone and followed you all the days of their life or walked with you, thank you. And I pray that we will be counted among the faithful, that we will walk with you and trust you, that we will have an unhindered closeness with you that will ultimately come to its culmination when we see you face to face. We love you, Father, and we thank you for Christ and that he ultimately made a way for us to have hope that this life is not the end. In the name of that perfect Savior, my Lord, I pray.